WBNC 8.7 FM Northport Community Radio Music News Sports Worship O Worship the Lord. Honda East at 7:00 and it's yours truly evangelist and pastor Gusby Edel Talk Sports. Heard the East at 5:00 p.m. with your host Hightown's finest Nick Morgulizer the Lord's Praise. Under East at 6:00 to 7:00 p.m. with your fellow worshiper Pastor Bill. With our website live, www.radiostation.com. For more information calling Dancing Machine at area code 941-257-8896. WBNB Super Power Station.
Amen. It is 6 o'clock, and that means it is now time for God Wants You Back. I am your host, Pastor Bill, joined in the studio with my lovely wife, Rose. And we are here tonight to bring you, I would hope, a message from God's Word in teaching and in song. And she has one chosen for tonight. And she did ask me to introduce it for her, reading the first two verses of Psalm 42. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God?
Until the very end. to the very end.
Amen. I do love being here with my wife, and I love to be able to have her perform live on this show. It is a blessing to me, and I hope that it is also a blessing for those of you who are listening. Tonight, I'd really like to talk with you about letting go of anger. Okay? Letting go of anger. You know, it's real easy to say, it's easy to talk about. It's hard to do. It's hard to do. You know, it's always easier to say something to someone else than it is to actually accept that we need to do it ourselves. You know, not that long ago, I stood right between two teenagers ready to fight and trying to calm them down. Did it work? Only because one of them said, okay, and the other one understood the consequences if he didn't stop. But how about us? Do we all have opportunities to get angry? Every day, sometimes many times in a day. But what are we going to do with it? You know, if someone has wronged us, we can confront them. That's the first step. We can take one or two others and confront them a second time. We can bring it to the church, right? But you know, that doesn't do much good when it's the chief elder that steals the parking spot you were going for in the church parking lot. Or when some nameless, faceless idiot cuts you off on the freeway. Or even when some unthinking, unconcerned individual buys the last Dove bar in the candy aisle. Anger, frustration, irritation, they all play a part in our daily lives. And sometimes it seems as if there is just no end to them. I'll tell you one thing that I've learned, or to be exactly a little more honest with you, I think I've learned it. When I'm stuck in traffic and I can't get around it, and I'm getting frustrated because I've got somewhere to be, and I'm angry at all the other drivers who can't seem to figure out how to get out of my way or to put their right foot down on that little pedal at the bottom of the car and make it go more than 30 miles an hour, I'm irritated because I can't do anything about it. That's when I need to stop and realize that God is trying to get my attention. He wants me to slow down in other areas of my life. Proverbs 19, verse 3. A person's own folly leads to their ruin, yet their heart rages against the Lord. Now, just to be blunt, our stupidity, our impatience leads to our ruin, and yet we get angry at God because of it. God, you were supposed to protect me. God says, you weren't supposed to go 90 miles an hour in the rain on a side street. God, how could you do this? I have an STD. God says, you were supposed to wait until marriage, or you are not supposed to cheat on your partner. God, how could you do this? I'm going to jail. God says, I told you to trust me for the money. You knew that was illegal. So what is one thing we need to let go of as far as our anger is concerned? Impatience? Is it easy? No. Is it immediate? Obviously not. No, it's a process.
It's one day at a time, one event at a time, one choice at a time, each opportunity, each triumph, each failure, as long as we keep going, as long as we keep going in prayer to God, repenting, acknowledging, and making the effort, we will succeed over time, not overnight. Now, we know that getting angry is not God's way of doing things. That even though God does get angry, and he has shown his anger, he showed it to Israel several times, in virtually every instance, God was angry because they had turned away from him to serve other gods, and because of how they were treating each other. So let's think for a moment. Now, according to counselors and therapists and several websites, anger is a secondary emotion. It accompanies fear, hurt, anxiety, or any number of other emotions, depending on the website or the therapist. So what can we do about it? Number one, when we are angry, and we will be getting angry, okay? We will get angry. The first thing we need to do is to identify which emotion the anger is protecting us from feeling. Now, anger can come up very quickly, so we need to watch out for it. We need to keep our direction going straight with Jesus, regardless of the torpedoes of hurt, fear, and frustration that attack us on a daily and sometimes it seems on an hourly basis. James 1, verses 19 to 21. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Okay, here's one key to letting go of anger. Getting rid of the moral filth and evil that is in us, and accept the word of God, which has already been planted in us. Here's one thought. Now, if we want the word more in our lives, we need to nurture the word in our lives and be doers of it, not just hearers of it. We need to add to the word in us with more of God's word and do our best to act upon his word in our lives. Anger is not really going to accomplish much in us that is positive. A great example of that is in Moses. Now, let me read this to you. It's from Oz Hillman's Today, God is First. Take the staff, and you and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together. Speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will pour out its water. Numbers chapter 20, verses 7 and 8. The Bible says that Moses had a unique walk with God. God said Moses was the most humble man on earth, and he spoke with him face to face. Numbers 12, verse 3, and Exodus 3, verse 11. When Moses met God at the burning bush, God said, Moses, I'm going to perform miracles through your staff. And he did. He turned his staff into a snake. He brought plagues upon the nations and even parted the Red Sea with his staff. He even struck the rock with his staff to bring forth water. But later, God called Moses to operate on a new level. Instead of using his workplace tool, his staff, to perform miracles, God was calling Moses to manifest the miracle through his words. Speak to the rock, Moses. But Moses, frustrated by the stiff-necked people, struck the rock instead out of anger. amazingly. And in spite of his disobedience, God still allowed Moses to get water out of the rock. You know, God will often work through your anointing, even when you do it in your flesh, just for the sake of others. But beware, my friend. It will be at a great cost. Like Moses, you will not enter your promised land and may lose your inheritance. God is calling us to manifest breakthroughs by operating at times as God did, by speaking to the problem. Be available to the Holy Spirit at times when God calls you to use your authority and your calling to manifest His power in a situation that needs a breakthrough. Friend, God is calling you to manifest His kingdom through a higher level of relationship with Him. Are you willing? I don't always quote Oz Hillman, but I do like his Today God is First. I do like to read what he has to say. And this time, I really think he hit the nail on the head. See, anger kept Moses out of the promised land. Now, what is anger keeping you away from? Proverbs 18, verse 19. A brother offended is harder to be won over than a strong city, and their contentions separate them like the bars of a castle. Here's the first thing. Relationships. God looks for relationships among His children. Mostly, He looks to have relationships with His children. Being offended, being angry, acting out in aggravation, or letting the anger smolder and build until every time you see the person you want to take their head off. God has built the bridge from us to Him with the body and blood of our Savior, and we are building walls up against each other.
Power Station.
Can love you, love, oh, earthly love you at your walking.
Ephesians 40, verses 30 to 32. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Do not offend or vex or sadden him by whom you were sealed, marked, branded as God's own, secured for the day of redemption, of final deliverance through Christ from evil and the consequences of sin. Let all bitterness and indignation and wrath, passion, rage, bad temper and resentment, anger, animosity and quarreling, brawling, clamor, contention, and slander, evil speaking, abusive or blasphemous language, be banished from you, with all malice, spite, ill will, or baseness of any kind. And become useful and helpful, and kind to one another, tender-hearted, compassionate, understanding, loving-hearted, forgiving one another readily and freely, just as God in Christ forgave you. You get rid of the one so you can become the other. It's hard to be useful, helpful, and loving when you are consumed with anger and rage. Even when the person you're angry at is nowhere around, those thoughts building up, those angry feelings, and then you find you're taking out those feelings on those you are supposed to be loving and helping. Now, malice is a word used here and in other places in Scripture. It's especially used in conjunction with anger. So let's take a look from my good friend Merriam-Webster and see what it means. Malice. A desire to cause harm to another person. A full definition of malice. Number one, desire to cause pain, injury, or distress to another. Intent to commit an unlawful act or cause harm without legal justification or excuse. Now, can you see how malice goes with anger? Anger covers up fear, frustration, or hurt, or any combination of them. Malice is boosted up anger with a side of vengeance. Take a look. It's used again here in Colossians 3, verses 5 through 10. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the lives you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Rid yourselves of it. Okay. You know, here's the question most people ask, and most preachers don't answer, which causes more anger, especially in those who want to follow God, but are not sure how to do what he wants them to do. The big question is, how do we do it? How? Let's start with 1 Peter 2, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. Amen. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. again, the instructions to rid ourselves of these things. But here the instruction to crave pure spiritual milk. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. Brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you are not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere humans? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere human beings? What, after all, is Apollos, and what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned each to his task. Okay, now, milk, the beginning food, the beginning of things, craving pure spiritual milk, the beginning of things, okay, I'm going to make a little jump here, okay, now, I'm going to make a correlation. I'm going to compare the two, and that is, I'm going to compare the milk, term used here, to the elementary teachings in Hebrews. Take a look. Therefore, let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward to maturity, not laying again the foundation of repentance from acts that lead to death and of faith in God, instructions about cleaning rites, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment, and God permitting, we will do so. Now, if these are the milk of the Word, the foundation, the beginning, the first things that you take in, see, when you come to accept Christ, the first thing that you do is you accept Jesus Christ as Lord, you repent of your sins, and the first thing this talks about is repentance, drinking in the milk of repentance, okay? Repenting from anger, from rage, from malice. It doesn't mean that overnight you're suddenly not going to have it anymore. It means that you acknowledge to God that it's wrong and you turn away from it the best you can. You ask for His help and guidance, okay? Repentance from works that lead to death. Now, if our anger does not work out God's righteousness, then by holding it, we are going the wrong way. Repentance means to admit it to God and try. And notice the word try here. We aren't going to get there overnight, but we are going to take those steps in our own lives to lead us away from it. I'll tell you, John Brevere has a series out. It's called The Bait of Satan. It's about how offenses are his bait to lead us into anger and bitterness and away from God. It puts up walls against other people. It can even put up walls against God. And it also details how to avoid the traps. And I'll be honest with you, it's a 12-part series. And so far, our Thursday night group is on 8 going into 9. The entire curriculum is about $130, and it's a good study for any church or group. The book itself and the video are only about $15 each, and you can get them from his website. But anything that helps guide us away from the anger and gives us guards against being offended could be a worthwhile investment. Okay. Number two, faith in God. They did teach people what faith was and what it meant to have faith. And I think that's something that's lacking a lot now. We look at some people, some churches and pastors use faith as a magic bullet, as the hammerlock that twists God's arm. But it's faith in God, not faith to manipulate God. Okay? What does it mean to really have faith in God? It means to trust Him. Number three, the cleansing rites. Now, to be honest, I'm not sure what they did. I'm going to give you an idea, okay? This is just an idea. Take it for whatever you think it's worth. When you take a shower, you're washing your hair, take a minute, say a prayer. Lord, as I wash this dirt from my hair, I offer my mind to you. Dear Lord, wash my mind from all the anger, wrath, and malice. Help me to see the hurt, fear, or frustration beneath it, and I pray for your healing and restoration from those wounds. Simple. Very simple. Offer it to God. Ask. Sometimes a simple act brings home the truth of what happens spiritually. And you can do this with your heart as well as with your mind. James chapter 5, verses 13 to 16. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Now, again, children of God, every time I use the scripture, I have to quote this along or give this along with it. You see, even in churches, not everybody is safe. Not everybody is someone you can trust. Not everyone is someone you can go to. Seek out those in your church that you can trust. Seek out those that you can talk to, okay? And you may make some mistakes along the way, all right? That will happen. Because some people, unfortunately, even in churches, they're there to find out what somebody else did. Okay? They're there to get the gossip, the good stuff on somebody else. It's sad, but it's true. They are. And the one thing that you tell in their ear, they'll shout from the mountaintops of the church. And the bigger confidence it is, the bigger a deal they'll make out of it. But you have to find people that you can trust who will honor God and honor your confidence and not spread it to others. But when you have something building up inside of you, when you are angry, frustrated, hurt, when something has happened, when someone has wronged or offended you, you need to have someone that you can go to talk it over with. Especially if you can't go right then and talk it over with the person who wronged you. Okay? You need to have someone in your corner that you can let this out to, so that it doesn't become a big festering abscess in your heart and in your mind that stunts the work and the will of God in your life. All right? You need to put that down with someone. You need to take that time. Sit down. Talk with a pastor. Talk with one of the elders in the church. Talk with someone and keep that anger down. Yes, we're going to get angry. Okay? Things are going to happen. But let's not let sin, resentment, offenses build up to where they block our usefulness for God and His pipeline of blessing to us. Okay? We need to find the safe place for us to set this down. All right? The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. We are righteous through the blood of Jesus Christ. So someone that you go to in the church can effectively pray for you. You can effectively pray for yourself because we're all covered under the same blood. 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 through 10. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar and his word is not in us. What things hurt us? Loss of relationships, loss of position, betrayal, all of the above. And each experience can lead us into anger and grow into malice toward the one who hurt us, the one who took something away from us, the one who betrayed us. What frustrates us? Traffic jams, slow traffic in the left lane, slow cashiers, people who do not keep their words, those you can't depend on. Sometimes even waiting on God. Proverbs 13, verse 12. Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. Oh, this is the hardest thing. To sit and wait patiently for God. It's almost as if you're suffering in quietness and you can't stand it. I know I can't, okay? I know I can't. One of the most difficult things to do. But it is in keeping with his word, okay? Hope deferred. That's not hope denied, okay? It's not a matter of, no, you can't have it. It's a matter of, I know the right time to give it to you. All right? Little kid wants a peanut butter and jelly sandwich at 5:30 at night when dinner's going to be served at 6. Do you give it to him? No. You wait and let him have a good dinner. All right? Does he get it? No. He's mad because he can't have what he wants right then. But you know what's best and when it's best to give it to him? So does God. Okay? Psalm 37, verses 3 through 8. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will do this. He will make your righteousness reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It only leads to evil. You can't combat their evil with more evil. Okay? You can't make yourself succeed against someone else by using the tactics of this world. Because the people in this world use the tactics of this world and they're good at it. We need to use God's design, God's tactic, God's way of doing things, not our own. We walk with him. Refrain from anger. Don't bother getting angry when somebody else undercut you and got the promotion, okay? Don't bother. Don't get... John Rivera, I was listening to I think it was the 6th or 7th message that he had, and he talked about this one person in an insurance office, and the guy was up for a promotion and didn't get it. And he was really upset, and he was thinking, because there was a legitimate reason he could have done this, filing a lawsuit against the company. But when he heard that series, he said, okay, I'm going to give it to God. I'm going to let it go. I'm going to go congratulate the other guy that got it. And he did. And it was 2 or 3 months later, he got an offer from another insurance company for double the money that he was making, a higher position than he had. In fact, I think it was a higher position than the one he was going for. But the fact is, God blessed him completely out of the blue. It was another insurance company that wanted to hire him away from the insurance company he was at, and he didn't even know about it until they made him the offer. God has things in his storehouse that we don't have a clue about. I found that out. Okay. Do I want more? Of course. Who doesn't? But do I trust that God is giving it in the right time? I'm getting there. I'm getting better. I'm not perfect at it yet. Again, it's a process, not an event. Psalm 46, verses 6 to 11. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Hear that, children of God. God is with you. The God of Jacob, God Almighty, is with you. Be still and know that I am God. Don't think he is God. Don't just... Yeah, okay. Don't blow it off. Know that he is God. Hold on to the fact that he is God. And remember that he will be exalted. He will be exalted among the nations and in the earth. If he will be exalted among the nations and in the earth, don't you think he will be exalted in your situation? Remember, it is still all about him, not about us. No matter what we're feeling, no matter what we're going through, no matter what anger, rage, or malice, and no matter how justified it is, be still. Know that he is God. He is going to be exalted. He is going to be lifted up. Here, in this lesson, as in many other lessons and teachings, it comes back to this. Trusting in him. Another reason that anger comes up is because of fear. 1 John 4:17-19, this is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Now, if we can't trust our own love because we know our love isn't perfect, we can trust his. You see, God is love. That means he does not have the attribute of it. He is it. Okay, so if we can trust God, we can trust his love for us, then we do not need to fear. All right, we do not need to fear his hand upon us. We do not need to be afraid. Perfect love, his perfect love, drives out fear. We don't have to be afraid of the punishment, because Jesus already took our punishment to the cross. Okay. Are we going to go through things in this life? Yes. But is Jesus going with us every step of the way? Yes. God is with us. as long as we are afraid, we are not walking in perfect love. I don't know that we can or ever will walk in perfect love in this life, but if we can trust in His perfect love for us, if we can love as best as we can, and if we can spend our time in the scriptures and trying to get this into our heads and into our hearts, then we will be at least making that attempt. Galatians chapter 5, verses 13 through 22. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. There are a whole lot of things that are wrong, a whole lot of the acts of the flesh, very few fruits of the Spirit. Forbearance, getting over an offense, not getting angry, keeping a lid on it, that honors God. That shows the fruit of the Spirit. That is something that can be prayed for, asked for, something that God is happy to give to His children that want to serve Him. Any tool that we can have to serve God is a tool that He would be happy to put into our hands as soon as we are ready to hold it. You wouldn't give a chainsaw to a 5-year-old. Okay, but the basic tools that we need to honor God, to walk with God, to do the things that God has asked us to do, are things that He is happy to give us, as long as we're asking them honestly, truthfully, Lord, help me. It's hard not to get angry, children of God. It really is. We go through life. There are things that make us angry. There are things that hurt and frustrate us. There are things that cause us pain. Dealing with the USCIS, the NVC, all the organizations I had to deal with to bring my wife here, I was frustrated. I was angry. I talked about wanting to fly back to California and chokeslam a few of the people that were messing around with the paperwork. Did I do it? No. Did I vent about it? Yes. Was I angry about it? Yes. I admit it. Did God know the right time for things to happen? Yes. Did He put the right things together? Yes. In my own life, I have seen God come through. And yet, sometimes it is still hard to trust and walk with Him. So I know when people are having problems, it's not a problem that I haven't faced, okay? It's not a problem that I don't understand, because I am just like the rest of you. I put my pants on one leg at a time. I mess up. I ask for forgiveness. I repent of the wrong things that I have done, and I try to do better the next time. Okay? I try to do better the next time. Children of God, let us do the best we can to let go of our anger. Not to let the sun go down on it. Not to let offenses rule our lives. To look at the initial cause, the hurt, the frustration, the fear, and then bring those to God. Without letting the anger cover it over, let's look at the real issue and bring that before the throne of grace, where we can find the grace and the help we need in our times of trouble. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, help us, each one of us, to let go of the anger, to turn away from the evil, and to walk towards the good. Help us to walk in the light of your presence, and let your word be the lamp unto our feet. I pray that you will touch each person hearing my voice right now in this week. Let them know that you are with them. Let us know before we say or do something. Let us know before the anger builds up in us that we need to let it go to you, and to walk with you. And help us to honor you with our lives. For those who are in need, Father, I pray for your provision. I pray for your guidance and direction. And we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen. Amen. I do have some referrals for you this week. If you are dealing with something, please take a minute and jot them down. The Riverside Church is off of 131 Daniels Parkway in Fort Myers. They're associated with the Discovery Life Center. The Discovery Life Center has therapists, counselors, many of them trained in Theophostic, and the Riverside Church has the Theophostic classes going on there. Their phone number is 239-689-6005. That's 239-689-6005. Cove Counseling is in Port Charlotte, Florida. They also have trained counselors and therapists. I believe they do have Theophostic trained, and they do have other things that they use as well. And their phone number is 941-629-0440. That's 941-629-0440. The First Alliance Church is on Midway in Port Charlotte. They have Celebrate Recovery on Friday nights. So if you are dealing with any type of compulsive or addictive behavior, this is a great place to be. They have dinner at 6, a worship service with a message at 7, and then a time of breaking into groups to deal with the issues that we have, with the compulsive and addictive behaviors that we have, and then a time of coffee and cookies and fellowship afterwards. Their phone number is 941-625-7435. That's 941-625-7435. The Peace Lutheran Church is on Gibraltar in Port Charlotte. They have they are part of the 24/7 House of Prayer, which is awesome. Their phone number is 941-625-4969. That's 941-625-4969. And if you're further south, out in Naples, the Tree of Life Church, their phone number is 239-530-2200. That's 239-530-2200. Children of God, there are so many things that are on God's heart. And I do believe that even at this time, God is preparing his blessings, preparing his time of touching and blessing all of his children. He loves you. He is not against you. Okay? In Romans, it tells us that all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose. It never says that all things are good. It says that they all work together. We don't see that when we're in them. We don't see them at the beginning. It's not until we're past it and we look back and we see what God did through it that we can see how God worked it for good. All right, children of God? And that's, again, where we need to trust him. And one of the main reasons we can trust him, children of God, is that we can know that God loves you and that God wants you back.
The only way you can escape
as I said earlier, don't beat yourself up. Get back in contact. If you go off the course, you rest and get back on course. Cool. He made a status for us on his website. Uh-huh. Cool.
I believe in God the Father, Almighty Maker of Heaven, and Maker of Earth. And in Jesus Christ is only begotten Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified and dead and buried. And I believe what I believe. It's what makes me what I am.
To a retired police officer.
I believe that he who suffered was crucified, buried, and dead. He descended into hell and on the third day rose again. He ascended into heaven where he sits at God's mighty right hand.
Holy Spirit, one holy church, but the community.